say there's no place I'd rather be than in the presence of God. Tell me. So good to see you. John 4:23 says this. It says, but the hour is coming and is now here when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship Him. I can tell you today that if you come with a heart ready to worship, if you come with a heart ready to serve, and a mind that is open, the Lord will bless you today. Amen. Can you give Him praise for that? How many of you want to worship Him in spirit and truth today? Amen. A few quick announcements before we proceed into the service today. Today's a special service. If you're a guest here, a first-time guest, or if you have a home church and you're here by way of someone being baptized, we want to welcome you here today. Thank you for being here. Would you give our guests a hand today that are here? Honored to have you. Amen. We will be having triage tonight. We do have Tuesday evening prayer for church-wide, anyone that wants to be a part of that. That starts at 6 o'clock, so you can come out and be a part of that. But tonight we will have triage. That's for your hurts, habits, hang-ups. 12-step program. Love for you to be a part of that if that applies to you. And also, I just want to make known to you that the last weekend of the month, the 24th, we will be having Friday Night Ignite. That's here on this campus at our church. It starts at 7 o'clock, not 7 o'clock, 6:30. Excuse me, I'm crazy. Starts at 6:30, and we want you to be a part of that. That's the pre-service for our Super Sunday service, and our Super Sunday will be the following Sunday. That is Friends and Family Super Sunday. So that's the end of this month. We want you to be a part of that. We want you to come and get involved in what God is doing at Ignite Church. Amen? Amen. Who can say praise the Lord that God is good and His mercy endures forever? Amen. Like I said, today is a special, special day. I want you to go ahead and be seated in the house for just a moment. We're going to do some things a little bit different. Great looking crowd today, as I said. Welcome into the house of God. Welcome to Ignite Church. Church membership is important. How many of you believe that today?
Yeah.
Church membership, aligning yourself with the church. The Bible says in the book of Acts, it says that church membership, the Lord added to the church daily. And that's what we strive for. That's what we pray about. That's what we fast about. And we ask God to do is to add not only to our body here, but to the body of the church abroad. So if you're here today and you have considered and told me and advised me that you would like to join our church, I'd like for you just to come and stand before me today. If you'll just come right now, it won't take very long. Those of you that want to, come right on. Would you give these a hand that are coming today? This is awesome. Oh, you're a big man. Wow. You do better than that. You can go to the church of the Lord God. Praise God. Each one of these individuals has a story, and the story is that God is good and that He is receiving them into the fellowship today. If you guys would turn and face me and just kind of scoot in so we got a balance line here. Here we go. I'm just going to ask you a series of questions and pray over you, and then we'll receive you into the fellowship. You realize that you're presenting yourself for membership, that you're assuming a solemn obligation, and it is expected that you will always be true to your promise and faithfully fulfill and discharge your obligation as a loyal member. You say, I will.
I will.
Do you publicly confess and testify that you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior in the full pardon of your sins? Do you publicly confess and testify that Jesus Christ will light your path and that you'll walk in the light of Scripture as He shines upon your path? Are you willing to abide by and subscribe to the discipline of the Church of God as outlined in Scripture and set forth in the minutes of the General Assembly? Are you willing to support the Church with your attendance, your temporal means, to the best of your ability as the Lord prospers you? Do you agree to be subject to the counsel and the admonition of those who are over you in the Lord? By the authority vested in me as a minister of the Church of God and a bishop, I take great pleasure in welcoming you into this fellowship Many of you are already members, but we're just making it official today. Thank God for this great group. Would you turn around and face the congregation? Congregation, will you stand? Congregation, would you accept these members into the body of the God Church? Let me hear you by saying amen. Come on, give him praise and honor and glory in the house today. I want you to remain standing. We're about to start worship, but while worship is going on, myself and Tish are going to come around and officially welcome these individuals into the house of the Lord. Amen. Can you say praise God?
Praise God. God and our King this morning. Come on, we can be better than that. Let's worship Him this morning. Let's give Him everything that we have.
Take away my heart.
I'm thankful for his blessings today.
Yeah.
Amen. I read a scripture out of Proverbs. It says, a person finds joy in giving an apt reply. And how good is a timely word? You know, I encourage you today to speak life into someone. Amen?
Amen.
A simple, I love you. I encourage you. I'm praying for you. Amen?
Amen.
You don't know what it's going to do to somebody. It can turn their day around. It can turn their life around. Amen? I pray for you today. I pray for blessings on this whole congregation. It encourages me to see these people that have joined today. And I'm encouraged to see the ones who are going to be baptized today. Amen? So let's pray today. Let Him bless you today. Amen? Let's pray over y'all for the day. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful, God, for this day. Thank you for having blessed us, Lord God. We're thankful for everything you've done for us, Lord Jesus. And Lord, use these ties and bless the people today. Amen.
So far down, and how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? I thought I
as a mighty big man. Oh, but I can't even walk without him holding my hand.
Sing this with me today. Come on.
Church of the living God has to grow because lives will be changed. Would you give him praise for the gospel of Jesus Christ? I'm not going to preach to you long because we've got a baptism service at the end, and I know that you didn't come to hear me, but you come to see. A lot of you came to see your loved ones baptized. We're excited about that, but for just a few moments, I want you to open the Word of God out of Mark chapter 10. And verse 46. And I'll read while you flip. And they came to Jericho, and as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. I want you to say this with me. Say, merely mediocre will not cut it. Say it again. Merely mediocre will not cut it. Mediocrity is barely average in the dictionary. It means that you are a perpetual underachiever. Nothing special. An apathetic state. Baldwin said this. He said, I have a horror of not rising above mediocrity. There is a spirit of mediocrity that rest inside the church from time to time. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
We can get into a routine, and life sometimes happens at blazing speeds. And how many of you know that sometimes bad things happen to good people? And sometimes our train gets derailed. And if we're not careful, we'll begin to live in a state of the world, and the world will browbeat us, and the world will come against us, and we'll begin to think and act like the world acts. But I've come to tell the Christian today that you are not called to a life of mediocrity. In fact, the Bible tells us that you're an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of your testimony. And the mere act of God reach down and grab you and put your feet on a solid rock. If you're saved and headed to heaven today, you're not mediocre, you're special. Somebody say amen and give God's praise to this. Larry Bird was a mediocre talent. Some of you are too young to even know who that is. But he practiced like a Trojan horse to be better, sometimes shooting 300 baskets even before the game ever started. Mediocrity will fight your spiritual growth. How many times have you ever give yourself a pity party pep talk and knew that you weren't where you were supposed to be with the Lord? And this is what we tell ourselves. I'm okay. I'm all right. I read the Word. I still pray. But I want to tell you, God wants you to go above and beyond going through the motions. He wants you to have a life that's overcoming. He wants you to be the head and not the tail. He wants you to be blessed in the city and blessed in the country. He wants you to put devils in flight. He wants you to call those things that are not as though they are. It's time to step out of the box of mediocrity and step into the place that God has for His children, an overcoming life. We all still listen if I take my coat off?
Amen.
I'm still saved, I promise you. Mediocrity fights your growth. Romans 12 and 11 says, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor. God laid on my heart strong this morning as I brought a word to the South Campus about remembering your first love. Can you remember when God saved you? Do you remember when He called you out of darkness? Do you remember when you may have got saved in an altar like these and hot tears streamed down your face and you couldn't wait to get out and to tell somebody what the Lord has done in your life, but all of a sudden life will happen and things will come into your path and it'll dull your blade? But I've come to share with you that iron sharpens iron, and so does one man sharpen another. I've come to spur you along to good works. There's more to your Christian life than what's going on right now. Right now, it shouldn't be bored. It shouldn't be the doldrums. You should be excited because the God of your salvation is alive today. He's not dead. He's sitting at the right hand of the Father. He's on the throne. God is not a God of mediocrity. He's not a God of the status quo.
That's right.
He's the God of the supernatural.
Yes. Amen.
You can only do what you can do in the natural. When the natural's not enough, your trust in Him will make the natural supernatural.
Amen.
You see, supernatural is what caused the seas to part for Moses. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Supernatural is what closed the mouths of hungry lions and turned them into little kitty cats. Come on, somebody. The supernatural It's what caused Jesus not to turn around and in a fury kill all of those who come to seize him, but let himself be taken. And the supernatural Paul wrote and said, the same spirit that's alive and well in the church is the spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. I want to encourage you, Church of the Living God, this is not a golf club, a country club, or a social club. This is the army of the living God. And we signed up to be servants. You were made for more. Mediocrity fights revival. What's revival? Revival is when people are getting saved.
Right.
Revival is not when you feel good.
That's right.
Revival is when people are getting saved.
That's right.
Right.
Amen.
So we think revival is about us. We think that if my four gets blessed, and I'll roll my eyes back and raise my hands up and roll around the floor a little bit, we've had revival. Well, you've missed the mark on revival if you think that's revival. Revival is when those who were cast out of darkness, come on somebody, those who grew up on the wrong side of town, those who come from the other side of the tracks, those who come in and they have a backstory and their front story don't look too good, but God's in charge of the home story. And he takes their life. Revelation 3 says, because you're lukewarm, neither hot or neither cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. Not mincing words, because I'm not real good at doing that. Mediocrity makes God want to vomit.
Yeah. Amen.
Hear me?
Yeah.
Status quo makes him sick to his stomach. Insanity makes him want to spew you out of his mouth. You know what insanity is? Insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. If you get a blessing, if you get saved, and you run trying to carry the message to the bar that God called you out of, guess who's going to trip and fall? Not all the drunks that are in there, but the one that's trying to run back and take the message. You need to get to a place where you're rooted and grounded in love, and the blessings of God shower all over you, and you grow up strong. He wants you to be like a tree planted by the rivers of life. He wants you to be hot. He wants you to have that zeal. He wants you to have that passion.
Amen.
He wants you to see change. Significant supernatural change. You're created for more than merely mediocrity. One writer said, one person with passion is better than 40 who are merely interested.
Yeah, that's right.
Let me tell you something. When God gives a directive to the passionate don't weigh the directive from God. When he told Joshua, I want you to march up to that city, and I want you to march around 7 times. Come on, somebody, hear me.
Amen.
And on the 7th time, I want you to shout, and the walls will fall down. Sometimes we in the church listen to the directive of God, and we try to dissect it to fit into our little lives. What happened to us saying, God, my life is your life. Take me as I am. Break me and build me back up again. You are the potter. I am the clay. I am in your hands. If you want me to walk around 7 times, I believe he said 7 times, and on the 7th time, God said he'll call the wall to fall down. He's just looking for some of us to get a spiritual backbone and grab hold of God and say, I'm not letting go until you bless me. Yeah. says you're fearfully and wonderfully made. Do you know you got purpose? And if you got a purpose, that means God's got a plan.
Yeah.
He formed you in the innermost parts of your mother's womb. If he not done that, if you were a robot that were put together just to worship him and serve him, you'd have no purpose. But because he knows your name, he knows every hair or the lack thereof in John's kingdom. He knows every time the sparrow. Come on, somebody. I just feel like somebody's lost in the shuffle this morning. I feel like somebody's just getting up, going to work, tending to youngins. Come on, somebody. Going home, and before you know it, it's time to go to bed again, and you've lost your fervency for God, not because of anything you've done, but you've become overwhelmed with life. Put God right back in the center of your existence, and He'll give you energy like you thought you never had. The Word of God says that you're going to be upon the Lord. God back in the mix. Turn off SL100 every now and then. That was the station when I was riding around Old Bay. Any Old Bay riders, don't lie. Raise your hand. I see y'all. You rag top down. So your hair could blow. Only my generation is. You ought to see the over. What you're talking about. Between us. Jesus came to Jericho in a hurry. In a few days he would ride into Jerusalem. This is the prequel to the triumphant entry. The last week of Jesus' life would be extremely busy. At the end of the week he would die on the cross. The apostles themselves had been arguing about who would have the most importance in his kingdom. You see, they were so narrow-minded, they thought that the kingdom was to come immediately. And they were fighting and jockeying for position. They were thinking about power and thinking about luxury. And Jesus had plenty to think about at this moment. However, in the middle of him heading to find a donkey to ride into Jerusalem, as absurd as that sounds, he should have came in on a roaring horse and claimed that city for who it was. He didn't have time for the throngs of people. He knew in and of himself that he was God Almighty and that he was about to give his life for a ransom. But let me tell you, Jesus wasn't mediocre. He decided that on his way and on his path to Jerusalem, before he ever got the donkey, before he ever sent the disciples to get it, before he ever entered into that holy city, before he ever heard Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, his ears heard and was not deaf to the cry, "Thy Son of David, have mercy on me." Can I tell you, he's passing by this hour, and his need he'll not deny. If you open your mouth and cry out, Jesus, he's not too big to reach down in your life and bless you. He never has too much on his plate. He never hits ignore on his phone. Come on. He's available for the mediocre. Bartimaeus led a life of mediocrity. Not due to his own doing. See, some of us lead a life of mediocrity because we don't want to do any better. Amen? I know it's straightforward, but it's just how I don't want to do it. See, there's others that are assigned to a life of mediocrity because of circumstances that have happened to you. And Bartimaeus is one of these. Now they came to Jericho. Imagine with me, if you will, the throng of people, the disciples, in his ear said, "Jesus, you don't have time for this. Jesus, we've got to get you into Jerusalem. Jesus, there are madmen trying to overthrow the government, and it's going to take you riding into the city to stake your claim." But Jesus takes time for the mediocre. This was Bartimaeus' daily life. Two beggars made a living out of begging. They lived from handout to handout. Perhaps one day they would get several dollars worth of change. And perhaps the next day there would be no change at all. Because you know as well as I do, there's always the scoffer that looks down their nose and says, get a job. Do something for yourself. When Jesus himself said, what you have done unto the least of these, you have done unto me. And Jesus didn't turn a deaf ear. He didn't turn a blind eye. And can I tell you this morning, it doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter if it's your health. It doesn't matter if it's your family. It doesn't matter if it's your finances. My Jesus hears the cry of his people. And scripture tells me that he is faithful and he answers our cry. He's a God who hears. And he's a God who acts. Bartimaeus had got to a place of conformity because of his condition. Your condition can cause you to conform. Conformity is when you blend. Come on, somebody. It's when you resign to the fact that it's never going to get any better. You ever been there?
Yeah.
It's when you say, this is as good as Kurt is ever going to be. I might as well sit here. I might as well take my beggar's cup. How many of you know that a cup is a small article? Bartimaeus said, this is all that I'll ever have for me in life that will fit inside of this cup. And when it fills up, then I've had all I can have for the day. But I serve a God who's not a God of just enough. Come on, somebody. I serve a God who tells me that he can do exceedingly, abundantly above anything that I might ask or think. While some of us are holding a beggar's cup, he's wanting to give you a bushel barrel full of blessings coming down from heaven. You need to broaden your mind and know that your God owns the cattle of a thousand hills, and that the gold is his, the silver is his, and there's nothing that he can. He's a God of blessing. But he had conformed to the world around him. See, they had a system. They would cry out and say, give us to the poor. Give unto us the beggar. Look at us. I'll tell you can look to man for your blessing and you won't be blessed. James wrote and said, all good and perfect gifts come from God. God wants to pull you out of the mediocre. And he wants to bring you into a place of extreme blessing. And I'm not talking about prosperity preaching. That's not my doctrine. I don't believe that. But I believe that God takes care of his children. Scripture tells us that every need you have, God will take care of before you even ask it. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Has he ever come through for anybody in here? Has he ever blessed you before you ever asked for it? Has he ever put food on your table? Has he ever put money in the bank when there was none there? Has he healed your children? My God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches in glory. The arrival of Jesus always confronts mediocrity. We like to paint a picture of Jesus as real effeminate sometimes. Come on now. Just real weak with a nice hippie beard. Just kind of saying, hey dude, cool. Not confrontational, man. That's not the Jesus that I serve. When Jesus confronted the demons at Gadarenes.
That's right.
Let me tell you, he didn't have to do anything. Meekness is power under control. And all of those demonic forces flew down into that one boy. And he bowed down and said, oh God Almighty, don't harm us. Cast them in pigs. And they ran down the hill and were drowned. God is a God of confrontation.
when he comes into your life, he will shake your apple cart. If there is sin there, he will rattle it until it comes loose. And if you try to deny him and just have a Sunday morning faith, he'll wake you up in the middle of the night. He'll cause you not to be able to sleep. He'll cause every song that comes on, Kayla, to speak to you until he confronts you and you give up what you're holding on to. If you want to come out of mediocrity, you've got to give up the mediocre lifestyle and step into a life. Scripture says, when he heard, understand that Bartimaeus had to hear because he could not see. But he just heard about Jesus. How many of you know that faith comes by hearing?
Yeah.
And hearing by the word of God.
Yeah.
Bartimaeus said, I've heard that he's healed others. I heard that Jairus' daughter was raised from the dead. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
I heard, hallelujah, that there was a woman with an issue of blood pressed through the crowd and touched the hem of his garment. I heard that Peter's mother-in-law had a fever. I feel the Holy Ghost right now. I heard that he walked on water and called Peter out there to walk with him. That same God that I heard about, I may not can see. Let me tell you, you may not can see him walking down the aisles of this church, but what you can't see doesn't mean that you can't believe it. If you'll believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is who he says he is, he'll do supernatural things. Sometimes you got to hear it before you see it.
That's right.
And sometimes you got to speak it before you see it. It was Jesus of Nazareth that he heard about. Let me tell you something. Sometimes a word heard has to turn into a word said. Because if you hear him and he confronts your mediocrity and you take it and you leave it here, and the only time that it applies to you is here, then you're never going to come out of the box of mediocrity that you're living in right now. You're never going to receive what God has for you. But God's looking for a group of people that'll get outside of the box and say, I haven't seen it yet, but I've heard about what he can do. I've heard about him raising the dead. I've heard about him healing the sick. I've heard about him doing mighty miracles. And because he's no respecter of person, if he did it then, he can do it now. And I'm believing just because I haven't seen it, I've heard it, and my hearing is going to turn into a word. And the word that I'm going to cry out is simply, Son of David, my God Almighty, I recognize you as holy. You're the author and the finisher of my faith. I pray, but now it's time to holler. Anybody know what hollering is? It's when you're desperate. It's when you grab on to God and the doctors has told you there's nothing they can do. And you say, somebody. God, you bless Aunt Sally and Uncle Bill. I'm tired of everybody around me getting a blessing. Let me tell you, you got to do like Jacob did. Sometimes you got to wrestle with the Lord.
That's right.
Until the break of day. Sometimes you may not see it, but you've heard about it. You need to start claiming it with your mouth. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. You need to say, God, you're the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and your God God too. Begin to break out of mediocrity when you begin to cry out to God. Romans 10:17 says, so then faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. He heard what he couldn't see. You see, he used faith instead of sight. That's why the writer said, that word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. You know what we want? Casey West, we want a Cuban. We want God to shoot a big light so we can see all the way. And we can go hopping down the yellow brick road. And God's got it taken care of. But you walk by faith and not by sight. Come on, somebody. And sometimes you're going to step into a place that you can't see in front of you. All you can see is the lamp to your feet and the light to your path. And you've got to trust God that every step you take, the light's going to be there. And just because you can't see the future in front of you, doesn't mean that God don't have a plan for you. Jeremiah 29:11 tells me, "For I know the plans I have for you, and they are good." Let me tell you, God is in your tomorrow. God is in your next day. Some of us don't know what holds the future. I know who holds the future. His name is God Almighty. And He'll not let my foot dash against the stone. He takes care of His children. He binds and rebukes the devil for my sake. He's caused all blessings to fall upon me. If He's brought me this far, Bartimaeus heard about Jesus, and then he cried out to something he had never seen. You see, he used what he had, and all he had was a voice. Some of you are in a place where all you have left is your voice. You've tried everything you know to do. But I'm going to tell you something. What you speak in faith, God recognizes it.
That's right.
If you trust in the Lord with all your heart, Proverbs tells us, and lean not to your own understanding, but in all ways acknowledge Him, the Bible says He will direct your paths. Use what you have left. I'm broken. Use your voice. I don't have any money. You got a voice. My health is declining. Use your voice. Praise God. Everything's falling down around me. When all the world falls apart, praise His name. When the enemy comes in like a flood, call on His name. The Bible says one can put 1,000 to flight. Two can put 10,000 to flight. Devils fear and tremble at the name of Jesus Christ. Sometimes all you can do is say, Jesus! Pressure made Bartimaeus shout louder. I'm coming to a close. Scripture says they warned him to keep quiet, but he cried out all the way. You know what happens if you want to come out of mediocrity? You got to get hold of some spiritual tenacity. You know what tenacity is? Backbone. Gut. Intestinal fortitude. Is anybody tired of being kicked in the teeth by the devil?
Amen.
Is anybody tired of the enemy trying to come and steal out of your camp? Well, let me tell you something. You can't kick a dog but so many times, and it's going to grow a set of teeth. God's looking for His children to stand up and say, not in my house, not in my home. Decide to be strong. And Bartimaeus had had enough. He had lived in mediocrity and darkness. He had begged for his last day. And the disciples said, man, shut up. He's got to go and get on a donkey and get into Jerusalem. We don't have time for this. All of the people were like, man, be quiet. He ain't studying no beggar like you. Let him go. But isn't it funny? The words of a blind man catch the eye Jesus. What you can't see, He sees. What you can't spot, He's already spotted. And when you call His name, He's got a plan for your life right there. And because of tenacity, Bartimaeus would come out of mediocrity. Listen to what Scripture would say. This was his only chance. Revelation 3:2 says, wake up, strengthen that which remains. 2 Corinthians says, in the time of favor, I heard you. In the day of salvation, I helped you. I want to tell you something, church. If you'll call on Him, He will hear you.
Yes.
If you'll call His name, He'll rescue you. Bartimaeus was tired of failing. He was tired of falling, but he kept trying. Most of us know Babe Ruth hit 714 home runs, but we don't know that he struck out 1,330 times. Most people don't know that Jonas Salk discovered the polio vaccination, but few realize that he failed 200 times before realizing the vaccination. Henry Ford went bankrupt 5 times before he finally succeeded. Thomas Edison failed over 10,000 times in his attempt to find the correct fulfillment for the light bulb. When an aide urged him to stop trying, he said, "Why quit now? We know of at least 100 things that don't work." You know the hundreds of things that we've tried that has not brought us out of mediocrity. Try Jesus today. He's passing by. I want you to stand all over the house today. This is the way that this story ends. I want you to imagine it with me, if you will. In those days, beggars didn't have a whole lot to their name. They had a cup. We've already talked about God expanding your cup. And they had a beggar's coat. It was shrouded around them. And it let people recognize that they were the least of these. Their cup and their coat signified who they were in society. But I want to tell you something. When Jesus comes along, you don't need a cup and you don't need the coat any longer. The Bible tells us that as he began to walk by this pitiful scene, and as those who were hollering, "Don't stop, keep going, Jesus," and as the voice of Bartimaeus split through the atmosphere, that Jesus himself heard, and this is what Scripture said. He said, "Come to me." And Mark 10 and 50 says that Bartimaeus, throwing aside his garment, rose and came to Jesus. And so Jesus said, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the blind man said, "Rabbi, I might receive my sight." Then Jesus said to him, "Go your way. Your faith has made you well." And here it is. And immediately, say immediately,
immediately,
he received his sight.
Hallelujah.
And followed Jesus. You want to come out of mediocrity? Get rid of the cup. Get rid of the coat.
Yeah.
Follow Jesus, and he'll restore what has been lost to you.
Right.
Every head bowed, every eye closed in the room. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this group of individuals that's assembled here today. God, I thank you for every life that's represented. God, forgive us for leading a life of mediocrity, just settling for the next best thing, settling for our beggar's cup and our beggar's coat. Lord God, you've called us out of darkness into your marvelous light. You're the author and the finisher of our faith. And God, I pray that you bless us here today. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if there's anyone here today that don't know Jesus, you've never come to a relationship with him. You've heard about him, but you don't know him. I want you to slip your hand up where I can see you. I want to pray with you. I would never embarrass you. But I believe you want to make a commitment to God today. I believe the word of the Lord has went forward. Thank you for that, man. How many of those who have to say today, "I'm not living like I need to live. I'm not where I need to be. I'm living with that coat of mediocrity. I'm living with that cup. Day to day, it's the same thing over and over again." Would you raise your hand and just say, "I need God"? I see your hand. I see hands going up all over the house. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Pray this prayer with me. Dear Jesus,
I'm a
sinner.
I'm a sinner.
I need a Savior.
I need a Savior.
Come into my heart.
Forgive me of my sin.
Restore me.
Again
unto you.
In
the name of Jesus. Would you give him praise today? Come on. So much for being here. I want you to be seated. We're going to start our baptism service in just a moment. Here's some instructions. If you'll just heed what I'm about to tell you. Ladies, you're going to be on this side. Guys, you're going to be on this side. Please give me time to get in first. Sometimes we have a mad dash and I can't bring up the rear, okay? I got to be in there first. So, but if your plan is to be baptized, then go ahead and you can get in position now. You can start to get in here. We're going to play a video while we get changed. Just sit tight. And we'll be back in just a moment.